ND filters are amazing tools. Akin to sunglasses for your camera, these special glass elements cut down the amount of light entering the camera, allowing you to use long shutter speeds during the daytime. For example, attaching an 8-stop ND filter to your camera while using an initial shutter speed of 1/60th of a second would allow you to increase your shutter speed to 4 seconds while maintaining the same exposure. If you want to know how this happens and how you can calculate these shutter speeds, make sure to watch my equivalent exposures video. But while ND filters are great for drawing out the shutter speed, letting you smooth out water and clouds, create light trails, and blur out walking people, among many other things, ND filters can be expensive, sometimes upwards of $100. They can cause a loss in sharpness if the glass or resin used in the filter isn't high quality, and many ND filters can increase vignetting in your photos. That's why creating a digital ND filter is so advantageous. Not only will it save you money, but creating an ND effect in the computer will prevent any sharpness loss and your image will not suffer from any additional vignetting. Let's talk about how to create a digital ND filter, covering the entire process from start to finish. First, how does this simulated long exposure actually work? Well, in many image processing programs, there are functions to stack images. Stacking images can do a number of things, but one of their applications involves averaging many images to produce desired effects, like reducing noise, increasing resolution, and even simulating long exposures, which is what we will be covering today. Next, what gear do you need? Really, all you need to create this effect is a camera with a manual function, a tripod, and a computer with Photoshop. A camera with manual mode is important since the settings between subsequent images should remain the same in order to make the stacking process easier. Because we are stacking images, they need to be aligned as well as possible, requiring a tripod to keep everything still. Photoshop can do a good job correcting for small amounts of shake, but shooting handheld may induce camera movement that can't be compensated for. If your camera or lens has image stabilization, it's possible you may be able to get acceptable results handheld, but just to be safe, I will be using a tripod. To reduce camera shake, I will also be using a remote shutter device. I don't think this is required for this technique, but it helps reduce camera shake since I won't have to press the shutter button over and over again to take my photos. For the software, I will be using Photoshop, but I believe the same methods used in this tutorial could be adapted to other image editing programs. Shooting the images is relatively simple. Find a scene that will respond to long shutter speeds, like a body of water, clouds, or moving cars. Set up your tripod and camera, choose a composition, and dial in your camera settings. To calculate the number of shots you'll need to take, you first have to determine how long you want your theoretical shutter speed to be. For example, to get a 10-second shutter speed during the daytime, using an initial shutter speed of 1/30th of a second, you only need to take 300 images. At 1/15th of a second though, you only need to take 150, and at 1/8th only 80, etc. So having a longer starting shutter speed in camera will reduce the number of shots you need to take. Due to this effect, I recommend setting your camera to its lowest extended ISO, ISO 50 in my case, to get the longest shutter speed you can, and then restricting your aperture size to around f8 or f11. If your shutter speed is still not fast enough, you could go down to f16, f22, or even f32, but the effects of diffraction will become strong, and your photos will see a noticeable drop in sharpness, so you may just have to deal with it and take more photos. When you are taking your photos, make sure to capture them in quick succession, because waiting too long in between photos will ruin the stacking effect. Usually, I just put my camera in continuous mode and lock the shutter on my wireless remote. Remember to use manual mode, meaning that white balance, focus, shutter speed, aperture, and ISO are all locked down. Once you capture these photos, we will edit them to create our long exposure ND effect. The editing workflow to create these digital ND filters can be approached in a number of ways, but I will be stacking the raw photos first in Photoshop, then editing the stacked image in Lightroom. First, I will import all the photos into Photoshop. Go to Files, then Scripts, then Load Files into Stack, and select all your raw photos. Click OK and check the box to auto-align the images and create a smart object after loading the layers. This step will take some time based on the amount of images you are stacking and your computer's power. Once the images are all compiled into one layer, click on Layers, then Smart Objects, then Stack Mode, then mean to sum all the layers in the smart object and produce the simulated long exposure. This step will, again, take some time. While we wait for the computer to process the final image, I just want to take some time to introduce to you Sonata Music, the sponsor of this video. If you're a filmmaker, video editor, or content creator, then you know finding high quality and copyright-free music for your project is no easy task. Enter Sonata Music. Sonata Music is a licensing platform that makes finding the right track easy. Sonata has competitive pricing, offering fully featured plans at only $9.99 per month. They also have high quality music, prioritizing quality over quantity, with music from actual artists, and only 10% of the artists who pitch to Sonata are accepted. Finally, Sonata is flexible, since unlike others, they don't lock you into a contract or make you pay up front for a whole year. So you can cancel Sonata at any time, and any content you publish with Sonata tracks is actually covered for life, even if you cancel later. I've been using Sonata for a few months now, and the experience is really great. Check them out by getting a 30-day free trial using my link below. You can cancel at any time, and any music you use and publish with the trial is covered for life, which is a pretty sweet deal. Thanks, Sonata, for sponsoring this video. All right, back to Photoshop. So once the process finishes, you will have a photo that looks as if it had been taken with a real ND filter, but without the drawbacks of owning one. If for some reason this method does not work, or if you have an ancient version of Photoshop without the stacking method, you can use this alternative workflow. First, import the photos the same way as before, but do not check the box Create Smart Object after loading layers. This time, Photoshop will simply put all the photos in a stack in the layer panel without melding them into one smart object layer. Next, we will need to stack the photos, but we aren't going to stack them using a fancy Photoshop function. We are going to do it manually. How we are going to create this effect is by manually lowering the opacity of the layers, working from the bottom to the top, creating the same effect as a mean stack. To make things a bit more organized, I like to number my layers from bottom to top. Starting from the bottom, I'm going to leave the bottom photo at 100% opacity. Then for the next photo, I'm going to take the number 100 divided by the image number. So in this case, it's 2. So I'll give the opacity a 50 or a 50%. The third photo following the same formula will have an opacity of roughly 33%. And doing this for all my 20 photos, I will be left with an end result that is effectively the same as doing a mean stack. Once you finish your work in Photoshop, save your image as a TIFF file to preserve the raw format, then open it in your favorite raw editor, in my case it's Lightroom, and edit your photo. So now that I have showed you the gear, the shooting technique, and two workflows to create these simulated long exposures, I encourage you to use this technique in the field. I think this method is great because not only does it work, but it fits my general philosophy that photography is more accessible than most people think. In that with just a bit more post-processing, time in the field, or better technique, anyone can produce stunning images with the bare minimum in camera gear. Thanks for watching this video. Let me know what you thought, and I hope all of you have good luck trying this method in the field. Thanks.
Thank you so much for watching this Apalapse photography video. If you would like to support the channel, the best way is through subscribing with notifications so that you don't miss any new content. Feel free to rate and share the video, and if you have any feedback, I will try my hardest to respond to your comments and incorporate any suggestions into future videos. If you prefer to read my content instead of watching it, or want to view other helpful articles, tutorials, and learn more about Apalapse, then visit my new website, apalapse.org. To follow me on my photography adventures, visit my Instagram page at VincentLedvina and also my print store. Finally, consider joining my Patreon for one-on-one support and extra content, check out my Buy Me a Coffee page, visit my merch store to buy clothing with unique Apalapse-style designs, and as always, PayPal donations are an option. All these resources will be linked in the description. With that, thank you for watching, and I hope all of you have a great day.